Hello and welcome to Total Health with Dr. Nick, where I'm going to do my best to inspire, empower, and motivate you to live longer, healthier, more abundant lives. And the first thing I want to do today, guys, is just thank you so much, literally from the bottom of my heart, because you are helping my channel to grow leaps and bounds. I mean, it is growing faster than I can have ever imagined. We've got hundreds and hundreds of people subscribing every single day, and I want to thank you for that. In fact, it's funny because I'm a regular doctor in practice. I practice every single day of the week, other than Sunday, of course. And, you know, I'm just seeing patients all the time. So now my kids and my wife are like, honey, you're becoming a YouTuber. So I'm becoming a full-fledged YouTuber. Who would have thought? But anyway, thank you so much. Well, guys, today is really about Q&A about keto. I get so many questions, almost so many that I can't even answer them every single day, but I always try. And the questions I'm getting, I'm seeing a lot of questions over and over again, so I thought what would be great to do today is to have a Q&A about keto and things related to keto. So hopefully this will answer a lot of your questions. I'll also reference back to some of the previous videos that I've done, so that way you can get some information on those. And I'll also put some links at the bottom, so that way you guys can connect to those really easily. So let's dive on in. Once again, keto Q&A today. So number one, one of the most popular questions I get, or the biggest questions, is always about the best fats to eat. You know, so many times people are living off of bacon and living off of cheese, and as I've said in the past, I don't recommend it because they're not really great quality sources of fat. So what are the best fats to eat? And obviously things like your oily fish are always a great one. Things like your salmon, your mackerel, sardines. I live off of sardines sometimes. I just pop the can open and I just eat the sardines as is. Olive oil and all, I love it, love it. Anyway, so your oily fish are always a great source. Olives, you know, Mediterranean diet's been popular for centuries and for reasons that are obvious, because they're so high in the omega fats, they're so high in healthy fats. So I snack on olives all the time. Of course, olive oil, things like that are always great to just drown your food in. Be careful of the calories because they can get up a little bit. But just lots of olive oil, things like your nuts, your macadamia nuts, your walnuts. Be careful of the cashews. They're not always the best source, but things like I said, like your Brazil nuts, your macadamia nuts, your cashews are always, your walnuts are always a great source of healthy fats. Avocado, you can't go wrong with that. Avocados are great. I had a question recently where someone said, I don't like avocado, so what can I do? Well, avocado is one of those great foods that you can just mix in with other things and you'll never even know it's there. So you can just put it right in a smoothie. I'm going to show you guys on an upcoming video a really great avocado pudding recipe that you'll be amazed at how good it actually is. But avocados are great, loaded and packed with so many vitamins and minerals, quality fats. And like I said, if you don't like it, you could just kind of hide it in with some other things, or make guacamole. Maybe you like it that way when you have some other flavors added to it. Of course, things like eggs. Eggs are a great source of omega-3 fats. For a long time, eggs were, you know, vilified, but now we know that eggs are fantastic. In fact, some of the fats are even more important than the protein that's in it. Of course, things like coconut milk, coconut butter. Coconut butter is easy to make. All you have to do is take some unsweetened coconut flakes, put it in a blender or put it in a food processor, blend it up, maybe add just a little bit of coconut oil to it to kind of get it going, and then just let it sit. And once you get this to a paste, it's going to start to render off the oil, and next thing you know, it's going to look smooth and it's going to look liquidy. So that's a great thing. You can put it on anything. You can put it on foods. You can spread it on your favorite kind of keto toast or breads that you like, and so on and so forth. Beef tallow, fantastic, great source of quality fats, especially this brand Epic that I like so much because it comes from grass-fed cows. So you want to use beef tallow. Beef is a great source. Now, people ask me a lot about lard. Lard, of course, is from pigs. I really don't recommend pigs so much because pigs are not a very clean type of animal. In biblical times, I talked about not eating it. I'm not saying it so much from a biblical standpoint, it's just that pigs hold a lot of their toxins in their meat and their fat. So you really don't want to use pig that much. So do I have some bacon on occasion? Sure, absolutely. But you know what? It's sparingly and it's rare. And I have pig or pork very rarely. But you want to limit that and use beef tallow instead. Of course, your grass-fed butter, fantastic. lots and lots of arachidonic acid in there, healthy fats for the brain, fantastic for the brain. So your grass-fed butter, avocados, of course, actually avocado oil, I use that a lot. It's got a really nice high smoking point, about 460 degrees, so it's great for cooking, and it's great flavor. It's not as strong tasting as olive oil, so you might like it in your salads a little bit better because it's a little bit more mellow. Right here, ghee. I found out about ghee a few years back. I didn't know what it was, but ghee is basically clarified butter and then re-clarified again, so it's really, really clean. Also, too, it's got a little higher smoking point, so for people who have issues with dairy products, you do pretty well on ghee. It's basically like butter. Depending on the temperature, it's either going to be liquid form or solid. Of course, as it gets warmer, it will start to liquefy a little bit, but it's going to be pretty solid most of the time. So these are all great sources of fat. I highly, highly recommend. Now, another question I get is on MCT oil. Very, very big. How much MCT oil should you take? And really, what I tell people to do, and this will work for you, is start off with, say, a teaspoon. And because MCT oil is pretty much odorless and flavorless, you could just eat it right off the spoon. If not, you can put it in smoothies. I don't recommend cooking with it. You don't want to heat it up. So I like using it just as to drizzle on things or right off the spoon. So how much should you use? Well, like I said, start off with a teaspoon. See how you do with that. I find that I made the mistake one day of just, I was in a rush and I just took a squirt of it from one of the kind of brands that I use. And I had a little bit of diarrhea after that. So you don't want to just douse yourself with MCT oil. Sometimes it could wreak a little havoc on your gut. But you know what? Start off slowly, add in more and more and more. And remember, MCT oil is a fat. So if you're on a keto diet, you want to make sure that you're including it in your calories as part of your total caloric load on your body. So make sure you're not looking at it like it's just, you know, almost benign, but you want to make sure you're adding into your calories. So start with a teaspoon, and like I said, use as much as you can. It's fantastic, especially if you need it for, you know, quick brain energy, quick energy for your body, maybe in a workout. It's fantastic for that. Also, I get a lot of questions as to which kind do I recommend. You know what? I'm not going to get into brands so much because there's so many different ones out there, and there's a lot of great ones. But the key things I look for is you want to make sure that it's, of course, organic. Number one thing I look for, make sure it's coming from organic sources so that you know it's clean and it's high quality. Number two, make sure that it's coming from coconut oil or coconut rather than palm oil. Better source is always going to be coconut. So make sure when you look at the ingredients or look at the back, make sure it's coming from actually coconut. And make sure it's got the two main MCT oils that you want, which is the caprylic and capric acid. Your 8 and your 10 carbon chains. If you're interested in finding out what I mean by, you know, 8, 10 carbon chains and what an MCT oil really is, go back and watch one of my previous videos. I'll include the link on the benefits of MCT oil and really what it's all about. So check that one out if you have any questions about it. But you want to make sure that it's got these two main fatty acids or medium chain triglycerides in it. Now, question I always get too is, what about MCT oil and coconut oil? Do I really need to use MCT oil, especially if you're making, say, bulletproof coffee or butter coffee? Well, there's big differences between the two, between MCT and coconut. So let's go over that right now. So when it comes to the amount of MCTs, MCT oil is 100% MCTs, okay? So medium chain triglycerides, okay? And like I said, on a previous video, I talked about what MCTs are. Those are carbon chains between 6 and 12. Okay, the two best that I like are the 8 and the 10 carbon chains. So coconut oil is about 55% MCTs. Okay, so the other different types of fatty acids within coconut oil are a little bit outside that range. So if you're looking for pure MCT, you're not going to get it from coconut. You're going to need to get it from MCT oil itself. Distribution. Okay, so where is the oils coming from? Well, coconut oil is caprylic, capric, and lauric acid. Okay, so it's got four main types of acids in it, which lauric makes up the majority of it. Okay, so once again, caprylic, capric, and lauric acid, whereas MCT oil is basically your caprylic and your capric acid. So the main ones that I recommend using. As far as metabolization, well, coconut oil, because it has more of the larger chain fatty acids, it takes a little bit longer for it to digest. It doesn't go into the system as readily. However, caprylic and caproic acid are, or capric acid, I should say, are readily put right into the liver to be used for fuel. So when it comes to fuel metabolism and using it very quickly for energy, your better source is going to be MCT oil. So if you, it depends what you're using it for. If you're using it for brain power, brain energy, or just pure energy, you're always going to do better with MCT. I always like to say that MCT oil specifically is the best part of coconut oil. So coconut oil is great, no doubt. It's one of the best oils you could possibly use. But when you want to make sure you're getting the best quality or the best part of it, you want to use the MCT oils. As far as appearance, of course, your best coconut oils are going to be nice and tropical smelling. They're going to have a nice coconut kind of smell. And it's going to have a coconut kind of taste. And it's going to be solid at room temperature typically. Now, when you get above, say, 75, 76 degrees, it's going to start to liquefy a little bit. But overall, it's going to have a coconutty kind of tropical smell and taste, whereas MCT oil is pretty much odorless and tasteless and typically liquid at room temperature. Okay? Very, very good. So make sure you're using this chart when it comes to how you want to go, whether you want to use coconut or MCT oil. Now, big question I get all the time, and I made a mistake one time of on one of my earlier videos saying that in the morning if I'm doing a fast, I use some bulletproof coffee. And I had a lot of people saying, wait a minute, doesn't bulletproof coffee break your fast? And the answer is yes, it does. Anything with calories or anything that does spike insulin in the body or cause a glycemic load on the body is going to break your fast. So bulletproof coffee, or I'd like to just say, let's just call it butter coffee, because many times people are saying, hey, do I need to put, you know, all of Dave Asprey's ingredients in? Do I need his coffee? Do I need his brain octane? Do I need all these different things to make it bulletproof coffee? And I think everybody's using that term now pretty loosely. But when you're talking about just your butter coffee, it's the coconut or MCT oil instead, and your butter mixed with your coffee. But yes, it does break your fast. So if you're on a fast, watch my videos on intermittent fasting. If you're on intermittent fasting or a prolonged fast, make sure you're not taking anything with calories. So if you're gonna have coffee, make sure that it is just black coffee, really with no sweeteners in it. Maybe some stevia, but sometimes stevia can spike sugar a little bit, but make sure that it's a very, very, it has cannot have any calories whatsoever. So yes, bulletproof coffee or butter coffee does break your fast. Now, question I always get too is, how much protein do I eat on a ketogenic diet? Well, guys, that's a tough one for me to answer because I don't know what your body weight is, so I don't know what you're looking for. I don't know if you're looking to lose weight and that's why you're using a ketogenic diet, or if you're just looking to change body composition, or if you're looking to change your hormones. There's different reasons people do keto. It depends on really what your goal is. And so what I recommend doing is, when it comes down to figuring out how much protein you need, just know that it's about 20-25%. That's it. So your total calories for the day, protein is about 20-25% right here. Your fat is about 70% and your carbs are only about 5. So just know that it's got to be in that range. So depending on what your goals are, keep it in that range there. Now, what I like to use, and it's very easy, is something called MyPlate. It's MyPlate app. You can get it in the Google store if you have Android, or the Apple store, and get this app, and you can actually put in your numbers, put in your goals, put in the weight that you want to be, and it'll start to figure out the calories that you need in the course of the day. And then it's got this great wheel in it that it literally shows you how much a percent of your calories are coming from fats, how much a percent are coming from carbs, how much are coming from proteins, and it also tells you the grams, so you can start to really figure this out and dial it in and be very, very specific. So this is the app that I like to use. You may be able find other ones on, you know, Google or once again the Apple store that you might like better, but try it out. Make sure you're using something like this to really calculate your macros. Another question I get is, what are macros? Well, macros are these numbers. Macros are, macro means big, so we're not talking about micros, not your trace minerals and vitamins. Macros are your big, big categorization of nutrients, which is your carbs, fats, and proteins. So these are macros. So if you ever hear me referring to macros, it's protein, fats, and carbs. That's what it is. Now, how do you measure ketones? Well, ketones are measured a number of different ways, depending on how deep into ketosis you are. In the first couple of weeks, yeah, you can use a urine test. You can use the urine strips because your body is basically excreting acetoacetate. And acetoacetate goes away after a couple of weeks. So the problem is you're not going to get accurate readings after you go a couple of weeks into ketosis. So you don't want to use little P tests anymore. You don't want to use little P strips. What about the breath test? That's measuring acetone. That's that sweetness on your breath. Well, the problem is that it's not always accurate because you might not always exhale or blow into the little device, the ketonics device, as same each time. And so you're not always going to get an accurate reading. By far, the most accurate way to do it, and it's not always the most fun, is to literally prick your finger and measure your blood glucose and also measure your blood ketone levels with a meter. That's the best way to do it. And one I like to use, I'm not typically the type that recommends different brands, but I'll tell you, when these things cost about $3 a strip, if you go to Keto Mojo, that's the one I like a lot, on their website, they advertise 99 cents a strip. So hey, it's a third of the cost of everybody else. So just go to Keto Mojo. Once again, it's a quick little, with the lancet, you prick your finger, measure your blood glucose levels, measure your blood ketone levels also, measure them both, and then you'll have very accurate readings. So guys, this is the best way to do it. Hopefully I answered your questions. Like I said, sometimes I get so many I can't even keep up, but I always want to make sure I get them answered for you so that way you get answers quickly. So guys, I hope you liked the information. If you did, please make sure that you like, you share. A lot of guys are sharing out information to others. I love that because you're helping other people. And what's the best way you can help other people get well is to share information with them. And you know what? The greatest thing is when you can save, change, or transform the lives of other people without even risking your own. Now, that's really, really a great thing to do. So anyway, like I said, guys, just like, share, comment, and subscribe. Make sure you're subscribing to our channel, and thank you so much for helping it grow. Make sure you click that little bell up there so that way you get notifications also. Once again, this is Dr. Nick thanking you so much from the bottom of my heart. God bless. Take care. See you soon. Bye-bye.